Hey everyone, welcome back to the Gamers Hall. I'm Chris, and today I'm here to talk to you about the new weapon mastery system in the UA that they just recently dropped. I think this has a lot of opportunities for role play, a lot of opportunities for the barbarians, fighters, and I think they said the monks are going to get this as well, but let's dive into this and see what it's all about. All right, so before I get into the weapon mastery system, one of the things I have to tell you is that they've changed the light property as well as the throne property. Now, the light property in this UA, they've changed it back to the way it was in the player's handbook. Now, the throne has changed a little bit because before it was part of your action to grab the weapon and then you could throw it that turn. But now you can pull a weapon from your person and throw it as part of the attack. So if you had a bandolier of daggers, and let's say you had three attacks that turn, you could throw all three attacks. Throw all three attacks. You could throw all three daggers, and it wouldn't cost you anything to grab those daggers. It's a part of the attack. And which means you could throw all three of those daggers and then draw a different weapon. Or you could throw all three of those daggers and, interact with an object or just do something different that you wouldn't have been able to do before. So I like that. All right, so as far as weapon mastery goes, there are nine new features that are with all of the new weapon mastery system that is attached to the barbarian and the fighter class, and I'm pretty sure it's going to be added to the monk class as well, which is going to get interesting. You have cleave, graze, topple, flex, sap, vex, push, nick, and slow. And I've already gone through and labeled which weapons have which, and we're going to talk about some of that, but I'm going to start in alphabetical order and let's talk about cleave. For cleave, the prerequisites of cleave is it has to be a melee weapon and it has to have the heavy property. If you hit a creature with a melee attack using this weapon, you can make an attack roll with the weapon against a second creature within 5 feet of the first that is also within your reach. On a hit, the second creature takes the weapon's damage, but don't add your ability modifier to that damage unless that modifier is negative. You can make this extra attack only once per turn. With cleave, there's only two weapons that get this starting out, and that's going to be your great axe and your halberd. Now, for barbarians, this is actually going to be quite amazing because you'll be able to hit with these weapons and then get basically an extra attack off. And even though you don't get to add your ability modifier to the damage, you do get to add your rage modifier to that damage because rage damage is additional damage. It is not the ability modifier damage. So you would get that on the cleave, which is a big deal. And hey, if you got a halberd, that means you could hit somebody, but then hit another creature that's within 5 feet of that creature as long as they're within your reach. That means you could hit the creature behind that creature. Which, I mean, could be awesome, but also the way you describe that in combat is going to be amazing. Like let's say you have a halberd, you slash the creature and do like a thrust attack and it goes through that creature dodges it. They don't take the full hit, but they take most of that hit, and then that's what allows you to go and hit the second creature and cleave it, and then get like a little gut check on it. I mean, there's many different ways that a player's going to be able to describe this, and I really like it. I'm glad that they're bringing cleave back, and it's not a feat, it's just something that's part of the mastery weapon mastery system. Flex. And now the way flex works is the prerequisite is it has to be a versatile weapon. And basically, if you're holding this weapon one-handed, well, you get to do the versatile damage even though you're only holding it one-handed. And what this basically means is, hey, if you're a sword and board guy, you're getting extra damage while having the extra AC on top of that. Or let's say you're a dual weapon fighter. So if you're a dual weapon fighter and you've got battle axes, now you can dual weapon fight and use the battle axes, and you're getting the versatile damage on all of those. And that's just something that is great that you're going to be able to manipulate with your fighters or your barbarians or whatever you're using. The weapons that count for this is your quarterstaff, your spear, longsword, war pick, and warhammer. I know I use the battle axe as that, and it's like, okay, well, you can't use battle axe because it's not on the list that gets it. Well, guess what? Later levels, fighters actually get to change the weapon properties as long as they meet the prerequisites. And a battle axe has versatility on it, which means they could change whatever the battle axe has to flex so that they'll be able to do this. But even still, like now imagine someone going out there and dual wielding spears, or someone's out there dual wielding long swords. This is just something cool that people are going to be able to do. It's going to get them a little bit of extra damage. Or if you want to be, sword and board, spear and board, you're getting the extra damage while getting the AC bonus as well. The next one is going to be graze. Prerequisites for this one is a melee weapon, heavy property. If your attack roll with this weapon misses a creature, you can deal damage to that creature equal to the ability's modifier you use to make the attack roll. The damage is the same type dealt by the weapon, and the damage can't be increased in any way other than increasing the ability modifier. This is going to be one of those things that, like, for a barbarian or even a fighter, like, you might want this weapon because even if you miss a lot, you're still doing damage. So it kind of takes a lot of the consequences off of this, which I think this is really good. And, it could be one of those things where even, let's say you don't have a high stat on that. If you don't have a plus three or a plus four, you're still doing at least plus one or plus two damage to these creatures on all these hits. And, if you have two or three attacks, now the only weapons that have this starting out is glaive and greatsword. And I mean, I have to say, good weapons to have this ability. So, like I said, I really like it. This is something that a lot of people, I think, are going to want or going to want to play with, just because it's going to be fun. They're always going to be doing damage. They're always putting numbers out there, and they're not going to feel useless in the battle even if they miss a lot, because they're at least still doing damage and putting the hurt on some of those monsters. Now, the next one we're going to talk about is Nick. Prerequisite is the light property. When you make the extra attack of the light property, you can make it as part of the attack action instead of as a bonus action. You can still make this extra attack only once per turn. This is awesome. All right, so weapons that come with Nick is going to be your dagger, light hammer, sickle, and scimitar. This is kind of a cool thing because basically you're able to make two attacks on your turn without actually having to use your bonus action. If you can use your bonus action to do other things, like for instance, the Frenzy Barbarian, now you can get two attacks on one turn and then still use your bonus action to make an extra attack. Let's say you're the fighter. That means you can make two attacks on that turn and then still have your bonus action left over to do second wind. Freeing up your bonus action is going to be a big deal. And not to mention, like, if monks get this, this means a monk is going to be able to do two attacks and always be able to do that martial art attack as a bonus action. So at second level, monks baseline three attacks if their weapon mastery is going to be one of these weapons that has this. And if you're getting flurry of blows at second attack, because I don't know what the new UA for that's going to put out, that means monks are going to have four attacks at second level, which is going to be crazy. Now, with
push, the prerequisite is heavy, two-handed, or versatile property. If you hit a creature with this weapon, you can push the creature up to 10 feet away from you if it is no more than one size larger than you.
This is Sparta!
And the weapons that come with push are going to be your great club, pike, and hand crossbow. This means you could be kind of like having this almost turns you into like a battlefield controller. So you're the fighter of the barbarian, and every time you hit this person or creature, you're moving it 10 feet. And that could be you getting it into position for another player. That could be you getting it away from another player. Like, you know, the owlbear just rushed up on the wizard, and you're like, oh no, I gotta save them. You can go up, bam, hit them, knock them 10 feet away. Now the wizard can run away to safety and cast spells from afar. Or, you know, you could push them like 20 feet away to maneuver them so that they're grouped up with an enemy. So now the wizard, cleric, whatever, sorcerer can now AoE them and get them a part of the blast. So this is going to increase the versatility that, you know, fighters and barbarians and some of the other martial classes are going to have in combat, and just like, you know, really give them a, you know, like a sense of battle tactics and some of the things that they can do. And it's going to increase the helpfulness of whatever you're playing when using this sap. The prerequisites for this are no other properties. And if you hit a creature with this weapon, that creature has disadvantage on its next attack roll before the start of your next turn. Your weapons that are going to start with sap are mace, flail, and morningstar. What this is basically doing is saying, hey, I'm going to attack this person or this creature, and their next attack is going to be a disadvantage. So you could be that person that comes in, hits them, and then runs away. And as you're running away on the opportunity attack, they got disadvantage on that. Or if you got someone who's been, you know, focus firing on someone like the cleric or the wizard or the sorcerer, then you can come up and hit that person or creature. And then when they go to attack them again, they're going to have disadvantage on that attack. So again, this is another way that, one, it helps it to where you're not getting hit as much, but it also means that you could be helping your allies to not be getting hit as much if you're allowing disadvantage on the next attack rolls for them. Could be super useful, definitely in the early levels. Now in the later levels, that's when, you know, this probably isn't going to be as effective because of the sheer fact that, you know, a lot of creatures get multiple attacks. And now here's the one thing. This isn't one of those things where you can do it once per turn. Meaning, if you hit multiple creatures, all of those creatures have disadvantage on their next attack. So if you're surrounded by monsters, well, you might want to use your extra attack to attack different creatures so that at least the first attack those creatures have are all going to be a disadvantage. Or maybe you're that guy who, you know, shows up and then you'll attack multiple creatures, making them have disadvantage. I can definitely see some combinations that people are probably going to do. You know, once you get to that higher level fighter where you can choose two of the weapon masteries, or you can change the weapon mastery with another one. And, you know, the more attacks you have, the more effect this is going to have hitting with multiple creatures or just hitting that one creature. All right, so the next one we're going to talk about is slow. Prerequisite is none. If you hit a creature with this weapon and deal damage to the creature, you can reduce its speed by 10 feet until the start of your next turn. If you hit a creature more than once with this property, the speed reduction doesn't exceed 10 feet. The weapons that come with slow is going to be your club, javelin, light crossbow, sling, whip, longbow, and musket. being able to slow your enemies, that's going to be a big deal. And like I said, this is something you can do in and out of combat. Reducing someone's speed by 10 feet, this is something you could do outside of combat, because maybe there's a thief and they're running away, trying to get away with something that they stole. Well, you could shoot them or hit them with one of these weapons, and then their speed's reduced, which allows them to be caught. Or it could be one of those things that you just don't want somebody getting away, so you're doing this to keep them where they are, or to buy yourself enough time for someone to do what they're wanting to do, or to do what they're hoping to get done. So reducing someone's speed is kind of a big deal, and I could see this in and out of combat. Topple. And prerequisite is heavy, reach, or versatile property. If you hit a creature with this weapon, you can force the creature to make a constitution saving throw with a DC equal to 8 plus your proficiency bonus and plus the ability modifier used to make the attack roll. On a failed save, the creature has the prone condition. Knocking creatures prone is always going to be a big deal. I mean, especially if you have multiple attacks. Yeah. So the weapons that come with Topple are your battle axe, your lance, maul, and trident. These are all really good things. I mean, imagine it. You're a barbarian and you have multiple attacks. This means your first one, you can attempt to trip someone, and then you're going to have advantage on all your attacks after that. And even then, it's going to be hard for that person to run away from you, because they got to waste half their movement just getting up. Or if they try to attack you from the prone position, that's going to be a disadvantage. Now, the only thing I would see that's a problem with this is the fact that some people aren't going to want to do this because you're not doing any damage. You're hitting, and instead of doing the damage, you have to hit them, then you have to make them do this save. You're foregoing the damage for knocking the person prone, which, as a group, this is going to be helping your group out a lot. And for you, it's only going to help you out if you actually have multiple attacks. Or if you're trying to plan something, maybe get away, because you can knock someone prone and then run away from them. At least they have disadvantage on the attack after that, and they're prone, they have to waste half their movement getting up. There's a better chance of you getting away if this happens. All right, so the last one is Vex. Now, the prerequisite for this, ammunition, finesse, or light property. If you hit a creature with this weapon and deal damage to the creature, you have advantage on your next attack roll against that creature before the end of your next turn. Now, majority of the weapons that have mastery properties, Vex has the most. So you have your hand axe, dart, short bow, rapier, short sword, blowgun, hand crossbow, and pistol. You getting advantage to hit the creature is always going to be helpful. But this is one of those things where it just continues. So if you hit the creature with this weapon and deal the damage to the creature, you have advantage on your next attack roll against that creature before the end of your next turn. If you have multiple attacks, they're going to have to change the wording on this one, I'm for sure. Because this means, what if you hit a creature? Does that mean if you have extra attack, your extra attack has advantage to hit it? And if you hit it with the extra attack, does that then give you advantage on the next attack before the end of your next turn? Meaning, as long as you're hitting this creature, you keep having advantage. So, I could see this one being kind of a problem, because if you're just constantly hitting, constantly getting advantage, that's going to be a problem. Where, if you're trying to hit multiple creatures, you just obviously have multiple advantages on multiple creatures. But, just to hit someone and constantly have advantage, because it doesn't specifically say, once per turn, just your next attack. Well, if that next attack hits, isn't it just repeating the cycle and you're in a state of constant advantage? I think this is one of those things that they're definitely going to have to reword this one you know, it is one of the stronger ones because it ups your chance of critical hits on top of that. Doing this with certain builds as well as, you know, certain weapons, the champion fighter is going to dominate with this ability because not only do they have the increased crit chance, if you're constantly rolling at advantage, then the chances of you getting your crit is amazing, and on top of that, the chances of you missing goes way down if you're always rolling with advantage. I'm not saying you're not gonna miss, I'm just saying that chances of you missing are a lot less likely. But now, what does this really mean for all the new classes? Like, this is gonna make some very interesting builds for multi-classing, like, you know, your Hexblade Warlocks or any of your Warlocks that are melee attacks. You know, this is really going to change it to where, you know, you might want to take a 2-level dip in Fighter or Barbarian to get some of these masteries to be able to do the extra damage, to do the extra abilities, to give you that extra versatility. Because all of these options are just giving you more versatility in combat, and crafty players are going to figure out ways to use these out of combat as well. Which, you know, some of them you're not getting out of combat, but some of the ones like Slowed, you know, that's going to be something very interesting. Okay, so one of the problems with this is like, okay, so a lot of them will say when you damage a creature, meaning you won't be able to use this out of combat as well, which I think could be interesting if they changed it to if you hit a creature or object, then you would have advantage to hit that object. Like, let's say you're playing darts, you could, you know, while you're throwing daggers at a, you know, a target practice or something, you would then have advantage to hit it again since you've already done it. You know, that's something interesting that maybe they might want to look at. Now, inside of combat, your versatility has just jumped up a lot. But outside of combat, you know, trying to figure out something to do with all of these outside of combat is what's really interesting, in my opinion. Like, you know, the topple. Topple is something you could definitely use outside of combat just to try and trip someone. Because just because you trip someone doesn't necessarily mean you are going into combat. Now, a DM could always force that and say yes, but not always. Cleave, you could be hitting something outside of combat, like the door, but then hit something past the door. Or, like, let's say, you know, you're Daniel in The Karate Kid. You hit that block of ice. Well, now you're cleaving through to hit those other blocks of ice. So, like, you know, you can take these outside of combat. It's going to be real interesting describing those things in and out of combat. Like, well, the nicking is just doing the extra attack. But I'm thinking grazing something. That's going to be something fun to describe in combat, how you miss this person, but you still manage to hit them and just do a little bit of damage. You know, pushing people, you can push, you can do non-lethal damage, which means you could hit people and push them around. A lot of weapons there, you could do non-lethal damage with, you know, just kind of push people around. Which, you know, you could be doing that to intimidate someone or to kind of show someone that, like, you know, you have battle prowess and they shouldn't be messing with you. And, you know, like, that could, you know, these abilities could be used to intimidate someone. And that's kind of a big thing as well. But I like all of these new weapon masteries. I kind of like what they're doing with them. I love that the barbarians and fighters are getting them. You know, that I definitely see some multi-class builds that are going to take advantage of these and run with them. Like the Bladesinger Wizard. Ooh, it's going to be hard not to take a 2-level dip into fighter. And now you can use a scimitar and get off both your attacks, but then you save that bonus action so you could Misty Step away. Or, you know, there are other spells that require bonus actions. What do you guys think? You know, are you glad that the fighters and barbarians have the weapon mastery system and that this is increasing their versatility inside of combat and possibly outside of combat? And, you know, what do you think? Do you like them? You know, the fact that you can change them in, you know, levels of fighter later on. You know, some interesting builds are going to come out of these for sure, and I'm interested to see how they're going to change and possibly edit some of these later on. But what do you guys think? Do these changes make you want to play a barbarian or a fighter more? Yes or no? Put it down in the comments. Until then, guys, like, share, subscribe, and I'll see you in the next video.